So welcome to this session. This session will be in English, but in French English. Okay, I'm coming from France. Sorry for you guys. So I'm going to talk about how you can add a search engine, like Elasticsearch, which is my favorite one, obviously, to your existing application. And this is actually based on my own experience when I was working for the French customs. I had to put Elasticsearch on my application. And this is basically my story here. So, during this session, if you want to ask for questions, you can go to this website, slido.com, and go to the Elastic channel and then ask any question, vote for the questions for your teammates. For example, then at the end of the talk, if I have enough questions, I will pick some of the best questions there. Otherwise, I will answer on Twitter if you have any questions after the talk. And so feel free to ask. I will manage that. So I've been working at Elastic for more than 4 years now, so don't trust me, try everything by yourself. Here I'm a bit biased, obviously. At Elastic, we are building an open source stack named Elastic Stack. This stack is made of Elasticsearch. This is the purpose of the talk today. So Elasticsearch is built for indexing JSON documents and being able to search and retrieve your documents that you have indexed. In a very scalable way. Kibana is a frontend that you can put on top of your data to visualize what you have in your system. We are going to use Kibana today, but just one part of Kibana, which is the developer console, which is super helpful to communicate with Elasticsearch. We have also another part of the stack, the open source stack, which are the ingest layer, actually. So with Bits, for example, you can Bits are agents that you put on your physical machines, and you can stream your logs, for example, with 5-bit. You can understand what is happening on the network card with packet bits. So it's going to run something like Wireshark on your network card and then send all the data to Elasticsearch. We have metric bits, and we have a lot of other bits that you can use. Logstash is like an ETL tool. You can extract from a source, transform on the fly, and reach your documents, and then load them to whatever destination you want. Our preferred destination is Elasticsearch, obviously, but you can use other platforms, like PagerDuty, for example. So Logstash, think about Logstash as an ETL. As a company, we are providing advanced features. So this is the commercial part of the stack. So the commercial part is made with XPack, which is a plugin, which adds new features like security, alerting, monitoring of the stack, reporting, graph exploration, and new from the 5.4 version, we have now machine learning, which helps you to understand what is happening on your time series data and detect strange patterns, for example, automatically. And everything that I mentioned is available on cloud. So this is our cloud offer. So we are running on AWS. This is totally different than the AWS Elasticsearch as a service thing that AWS is proposing. So here you have access to all the open source stack and the XPack offer as well. So as a service, we are managing that for you, and we have an enterprise version, which you can deploy on your own infrastructure if you wish. And that's all for the commercial part. Yeah. So, I'm David Pilato, and I'm Dadoune on Twitter, so you can follow me. At the end of the talk, I will paste a link to the repository that I'm going to use today. Part of the Elastic team, I have been working on Elasticsearch project itself, so mainly on plugins and on open source plugins. That was my main activity on the project. Recently, I started to focus more on evangelism, so that's the reason you see the number of commits decreasing a lot now. Still a shame, but traveling a lot. Well. So for this demo, I'm going to use this repository, which is available on my GitHub account. So I'm going to paste that link at the end. And basically, if you want to replay all what I'm going to show you today, you just have to go from one branch to another and just follow the README guide here, and then go to the other branch and see what are the differences between one branch and the other. Okay, so let's start. I have an application running here on my laptop, and this application is about marketing data. Let's say that I'm collecting information about people, so persons, and I have some information about them, and I already have my application ready here, and behind the scene I'm using MySQL, and I'm performing some searches using MySQL. So if I look at my application, for now I have no data at all, so the first thing I'm going to do is to inject some documents, some persons. So I'm going to use a random script to generate persons and store them inside MySQL here. So, okay, this is happening. While this is happening, I can search for people, okay? So I can search within different columns here, like the name. I can probably search for the city, yeah. I can search for France. This is super interesting, actually, as a result. If you notice here, when I'm searching for France, the second result that I have is France-Gall here. And I would expect it to be on the top of the list, because France-Gall is the name of the person, and I'm not specifically looking for people living in France. Maybe I'm looking for people living in France, but this object, I think, is more relevant for my use case than the other. So I would expect it to be on the top of the list. It's not here. We'll see if we can fix that. So let's search for Joe Smith. Okay, it's working. Can we search for Smith Joe? Ah, does not work anymore. We will see with the implementation that I have today that, okay, it cannot work. As is, I need to change my code if I want to make it work. And let's do some typo. G, Smooth. Okay, it does not work as well. So this is something we should fix. And to do that, we need to use a search engine. Before switching to a search engine, I want to describe what is the application that I have today, the model. So I have a really simple model here, as beans. I have a person bin, so this is the top level entity that I have. So I have a name field, date of birth, gender. Then I have an address, which is managed by this bin here. And then I have some counters, marketing data. And if I look at the MySQL schema, it's super similar. I have a table for person, I have a table for the address, and I have a table for the marketing. Okay. If we look at the code, when I'm coming, oh, I forgot to show you something. But when I'm coming from this interface, I have a simple search bar here. This is what the user is looking for, the query. So I'm using Hibernate behind the scene. Here, I'm generating a query. And for this query, I'm going to use a like percent strategy, like a full scan. With what the user has entered, and I'm going to do a join with the address table, because I have two tables here that I'm interested in, and then I'm going to search within the name field, address.country and address.city field. So this is the search like Google operation. I have also another feature that you can see here. I have the advanced search, where I can specifically search within some fields. So I'm searching for Joe, living in France, in Paris, okay? If I look at the implementation here, from the interface, I'm getting the name field, the country field, and the city field. And if I have anything in the name field, I want to use my, again, like percent strategy on the name field. If I have anything in the country, I will search within the address.country field, and same for address.city. So basically, this is what I have today. So I have my database, I want to use a new another search engine to fix basically the issue that I have seen before. So what can I do for that? First, I need to choose the search engine. I will choose the best search engine ever, which is Elasticsearch. Okay, I'm biased, I told you. But you have now to ask yourself a question. How can I send the data from the database to Elasticsearch? So I can use an ETL. I can use something like Talent, for example, or MuleVSB, or Logstash, why not? And run every 5 minutes a script, which is going to fetch the data from the database, and then transform that to JSON documents, and then send that to Elasticsearch. But it's not really real time, right? If I run this batch every 5 minutes, then it means that when my user click on the save button in the application and save a new entity, I will have to wait for 5 minutes before the batch process the data. So it's not real time. And then how do you deal with updates? When I'm updating a document, what should I do? Should I process again the full database again on every run, every 5 minutes? Or should I have like a technical field saying that, oh, here are the new change from the last time I processed the data? What about deletes? When you remove something in the database, the ETL needs to know that something which is not coming back again has to be removed, which is super tricky to solve, right? So you can use triggers, you can use other stuff, but to me it's super hard. So my opinion is if you have access to the application which is generating the data in the same transaction, send directly the data to Elasticsearch. Right. If you can hack your application, this is the best way to do. And this is what we are going to do now. We are going to change the way our application is acting today and see what we can do with that. So the first thing I need to do is to add Elasticsearch itself. So I'm going to use a client here. So for the demonstration, I'm going to use what we call a transport client, which is going to become the legacy client that we have. We are building a REST client, but it's not available yet. So for now, it's this one. And then I'm going to change one of my method in my service layer. I have a save method. This save method is saving an object in the database using Hibernate. And what I told you is that I want here to save my object to Elasticsearch as well. So I'm going to create an Elasticsearch DAO, and I want to save this person object. So let's create this field. I need to create that class, Elasticsearch DAO. Create that class in the DAO package. Okay. Here I'm using a RESTX framework. So with RESTX, I can do some injections. So I'm going to annotate this class as a component for RESTX. And then I have my DAO. I need to inject it. So let's add it somewhere. Does it work? Okay. So I have now my Elasticsearch DAO instance here. I can implement this save method. Okay. So what do I need to create this object in Elasticsearch? I first need an Elasticsearch client. So let's create the client here. So what is that? Private client. Let's call it client. Final. Okay, I need to initialize it. So I'm going to use a class which is provided by the transport client that I added before. So what I'm basically doing here, I'm saying that I'm going to use the pre-built transport client class with no settings. And I'm going to provide the potential list of the address where Elasticsearch is running. And by default, Elasticsearch will run locally, on this default port of Elasticsearch. So this is the transport port. The REST port is actually 9200, but here I'm using the transport client, so I'm using the 9300 port. Okay, so I have a client, but if you speak with Elasticsearch, you need to speak with and provide JSON documents, right? So to do that, I'm going to use another library. The name is Jackson, and I'm going to use an object mapper from the from Jackson, and I can actually inject this. This is coming from a RESTIC, so I can just inject the mapper. Okay, so I have Jackson. What can I do? I need to serialize my bin as bytes or string, whatever, using Jackson. So this is my bin person, and let's yes, add an exception here. Let's do that. So I have a byte array, and I need to send that to Elasticsearch now. So I'm going to use my client, and I'm going to do an index operation. I need an index request. I need to provide to Elasticsearch what is the index name. I'm going to store everything in an index name person. What is the type name? For now, it will be person. And what is the ID of the document? So the ID is generated by Hibernate here. So I can get it here as a string. Then I need to provide a JSON document itself. So I can say this is the JSON document, so the bytes here, and this is a JSON content. And then I need to execute that and get the response back. So basically, with those two lines of code, I'm able to send something inside Elasticsearch, right? With all the glue elsewhere. Okay. Let's compile that. I'm pretty sure I have an issue. Yes. So something can go wrong here, right? You can have an error while you are communicating with Elasticsearch, for example. So what can you do? You can say, maybe I can just surround with try-catch, and I'm going to write some pseudocode. This is not exactly what you should do. But you can say, you can write something like, okay, I want to roll back the current transaction and fail, basically. Here, for my use case, I don't want to do that, because to me, for my use case, it's super important when the user hit the save button in my application that the entity is actually saved in the database. So I just want to warn the upstream that something is wrong. Maybe I should send that to a message queue system, whatever. So Houston, we have a problem. Why not? With the exception. Okay. So I'm not going to roll back anything, I'm just going to skip the insertion inside Elasticsearch. I mentioned that when you want to remove a document in the database, you should warn Elasticsearch that something has to be removed. How can we do that? If I look at the same in the service layer, I have also a delete method to remove something from the database. And here, just after removing the object in the database, I can call Elasticsearch again, add a new method, delete, and I can say, okay, remove that document. Let's create this method. ID a string. What should I do? I'm going to use my client again. This time I'm going to do a delete call with a delete request. What I want to delete is stored in an index name person. The type is person again. And what is the ID of the document I want to remove? The ID that I just provided. And I just need to execute and get the response back. And let's send some exceptions. Yeah. Why not? So I'm sure I have the same issue. And let's run with try-catch. Okay. So I think I'm almost done for that part. I need something. I need to start Elasticsearch. So I have downloaded already Elasticsearch here. I have like a standard version of Elasticsearch. So this is the version 5.4.1, which is the latest version that we have. So I'm starting Elasticsearch. I just added the XPath plugin, but I'm not going to use it here. And then I'm going to start another project. I mentioned it, which is Kibana. So I'm going to just launch it. So Kibana is going to connect with to Elasticsearch, and Kibana is going to provide me an interface here. So let's have a look. In this interface, I'm interested in the dev console. So I'm just going to check that everything is running. So I'm connected. Kibana is connected to Elasticsearch, and Elasticsearch is running. And if I look at the index that I have, I don't have any index name person so far, right? So I did not index anything yet. So let's restart the application. Okay, the application has started. I still have no documents. So I need to index again, let's say 1,000 documents inside MySQL, and in parallel, I'm going to index that inside Elasticsearch, as we have seen before. So let's do that. As you can see, it's much slower than it was, right? So we need to fix that probably. We don't want to spend so much time on Elasticsearch and reduce the bandwidth. If I look at the console again and go here, I can see the number of documents increasing. Okay, so my documents are coming. I can search. So those are the 10 first documents that I have indexed. So you can see the JSON version of my entities that we have seen before. So this is generated by Jackson. Yeah. Right. I'm done. Okay. But still, when we are searching here, we are still using the database. I did not change anything yet. Okay, so I need now to remove and to change and to switch the search part to Elasticsearch. So where should I do that? I have a search method here. So in this search method, I'm going to remove all that. So that was using Hibernate behind the scene, and now I want to use only Elasticsearch. So I'm going to use a class named Query Builder here. So I'm going to express what is the query I want to run. So if the user did not set anything in the search bar, then I want to run a specific query inside Elasticsearch, which is Query Builders, which is the natural query, which means give me everything that you have, right? Give me all the records. Otherwise, if the user entered anything, the query I want to use is another one, Builders, is the multi-match query. What I want to search for, I want to search for Q, which is what the user entered. And I want to search that within some fields. By default, when you provide a JSON document to Elasticsearch, every field is indexed. So I can search in whatever field I want. Name, gender, why not? Address dot city, address dot country, for example. Okay, I have the query. What can I do with that? Let's call the DAO again and add a search method. Let's provide a query. And I'm going to show you that you can deal with pagination super easily. So from the interface, I have the size of a page and the page number. So I can do that. Let's create this method. Okay. What do I need to do? I'm going to call the prepare search method here. I can narrow my search within some indices because Elasticsearch is multi-tenant, so you can search across multiple indices at the same time. but here I'm going to search only in person index. What is the query? So the query I generated before, and pagination, as I said, is super easy. You just have to send the form and size parameters. Size. And execute that and get the response back. So this is a response object, and I'm going to return this response object here. Okay, so now I have this method, I have a response, and my application is not that legacy. I'm not using a servlet or GSP or whatever, or struts. So I'm using AngularJS here, so I have a... My talk is about the backend, not about the frontend. So I'm just going to send back a JSON document to the frontend, and that's all. Probably you will have to do something else. So send a response as a JSON document. Okay, I have something. Can we do something for the advanced search? So let's do something super similar. I'm going to remove the call to the database, and I'm just going to use Elasticsearch now. And I'm going to type super fast. Okay. So again, I'm going to build a query. If I have nothing in name, nothing in country, and nothing in city, then I want to run a matchall query again, so give me all the results. Otherwise, I'm going to build what we call a Boolean query, and if I have anything in name, it must match on the name field. If I have anything on the country field that the user entered, then it must match on the address.country, and same for city. And then I'm calling the same search method that we have seen before. Okay, let's restart. So now I'm using Elasticsearch behind the scenes. So if I'm searching for anything, okay, I have the result. If I'm searching for Joe, not working, okay. But G-O is working well, okay. Joe Smith, okay. Smith, Joe. Ah, okay, I have result now, right? It's working as I would expect. Let's search in some other fields, like France. So France, I need to have the full term. But now, what is interesting, that by default, my France guy is on the top of the list, right? This is more relevant for my use case, right? Okay, but I need to fix some few things. Before fixing the problem that we have here, and I'm going to describe why we have this problem, I want to fix what we have seen here. Right. The injection rate was super slow. Why this? Because we were doing one index operation per one index operation, which is super slow in Elasticsearch. A better way for doing that is by using what we call the bulk processor. So the bulk processor, or the bulk API, and in the Java we have a nice class named bulk processor. I'm going to describe what it is here. Yeah, I'm typing fast again. That's it. Logger. I need a logger. Okay. So, the bulk processor here, I'm building a bulk processor, providing a client, then providing a listener. And what I'm saying, I'm going to add some actions to the bulk processor. So, index request, delete request, what have you. And then, every 10,000 actions, I want the bulk processor to flush the request to Elasticsearch directly. And even if I don't have 10,000 actions in my bulk, I want the bulk processor to flush every 5 seconds, whatever the number of actions I have in the bulk processor. And then you can provide a listener here, before the execution of the bulk, after the execution of the bulk, or after the execution of the bulk, with a big failure. No transaction in Elasticsearch, not at all. Right. So I need to change that. Instead of indexing the document, I'm going to use the bulk processor now, and I'm going to add this index request to the bulk processor. And I can do exactly the same thing for the delete request. here, and I'm not going to call get. Okay, so using a bulk processor is that, and we are going to see what is the effect later. I'm not going to restart now, I will restart just after the next step. I want to explain why, when I was searching for G instead of GOE, it was not matching, actually. So, by default, Elasticsearch is generating a schema for you, which means that when you create the first document, it will try to guess what you want to do with the search engine. And basically, here, Elasticsearch has seen that you want to provide a property which name is name, the name field, and you want to run full text search on it. And behind the scene, we are going to analyze the text that you are providing using what we call a standard analyzer by default. What this analyzer is doing, you can see that with the underscore analyze API that we have. When you index a document where the text contains Joe Smith, it will actually index in the inverted index in Lucene two terms, which are Joe and Smith. And when you are searching, for Joe, G-O, or whatever, it will basically go through the same process. So if I'm searching for Joe, I'm going to copy this line. If I'm searching for Joe, it will try to find if in the inverted index I have G-O, but I don't have G-O in the inverted index. I have exactly G-O-E, not G-O. Right. So I need to tell Elasticsearch to act differently at index time. And to do that, I'm going to provide to Elasticsearch what we call an analyzer, a specific analyzer. So I'm going to show you what is going to happen behind the scene. So when you create an index, you can provide index settings here. This is what I'm doing. And I'm providing my own analyzer. I don't have enough time to explain all the details behind the scene, but you are going to understand what is happening. So I'm going to use here what we call an edge n-gram type of tokenizer. And when I analyze the same text again with the n-gram analyzer, this is actually what is going to be indexed in the inverted index. So now I will have G, G-O, G-O-E, S, S-M, etc., etc. So I will be able to search for G now and G-O. Right. So this is going to produce more tokens, obviously, but it will solve the issue. And in Elasticsearch, we don't want to use wildcard queries. This is ever, right? Don't use wildcard queries, ever. Okay, I need to provide these index settings and I need to provide a mapping to Elasticsearch. But instead of doing that manually, I'm going to use a project that I built, which is open source. Yeah. And the name is Beyonder. So what Beyonder is doing, Beyonder is going to look inside the ClassPass. So no, first I'm going to call it here. So when I'm building my client here, I'm going to use Elasticsearch Beyonder. I want to start it with a client. Whatever happened. With this call, Beyonder is going to look within the class pass if you have a directory named Elasticsearch by convention. Elasticsearch. And in this directory, if you have another directory, it will be the index name, so person. So basically, here I'm going to tell Beyonder that it needs to create an index. And if I have a file name underscore settings.json inside this directory, Beyonder will use that as index settings. So here I can provide the analyzer that I have shown before. And if I have another file, which is the type name, so person.json, then I can provide the mapping that I want Elasticsearch to apply for my use case. So instead of automatically guessing For me, I want to force Elasticsearch. And I want to say, you know, that for the name field, I will still use the same strategy that we have seen before, which is by default, I mean, just search with the full term. But at index time, what you are going to do, you are going to copy the content of the name field to another field, which name is full text here. And I have defined full text here. And for this full text field, I'm going to use my n-gram strategy that we have seen before. So I'm going to index that full text field differently that we have seen. If I look at the address.city, I'm going to say that by default, if you search within the address.city, you are going to use the same analysis chain that we have seen before, the standard one. We are going to copy address.city within the full text field again. So I will be able to search within city field, actually by searching within the full text field. But also at index time, I want Elasticsearch to generate two other fields. I want to generate a field named address.city.autocomplete, where I'm going to use again the same n-gram strategy. Why not? And then I'm going to compute some aggregations. So I'm going to generate address.city.ags field name. And I'm going to use a different type of field, which name is keyword. This is built for sorting and aggregation, basically. Okay. I need to remove my index first, otherwise it won't work. So remove this one, and I need to remove person index. Delete. Okay. I don't have the person index anymore, so I can restart now my application. I hope that everything is okay. We should see in the logs that Beyonder is working. Rock and roll is okay. Okay, so if I look at my mapping for my index person, now I can see that all the things that I have provided before has been sent by Beyonder to Elasticsearch. Okay, so I can index again some person. So let's index 1,000 documents. So it's faster than it was. Okay, we are almost at what we have seen before. That's okay. Can we search for Joe? So it still does not work, right? Why this? Because if you remember the code, where is that here? We are still looking here and searching within the name field, gender field, and address.country and address.city, which are not using the n-gram strategy. So instead of that, I'm going to search within the full text field here. Right. And I can say, OK, if you find what I'm looking for in the name field, I want to boost the result. Right. The name field is much more relevant for me than the other fields. This is what I'm saying here. So let's compile that and see. Okay, can I search for Joe? So now Joe is working, right? Paris, France, okay. So I have the result that I'm expecting, so I'm back. Not yet for the advanced search. I did not fix yet the problem because I'm still using for the advanced search. I'm still searching inside the name field. Instead, I need to search in this autocomplete subfield, which is generated at index time. Now, okay, I can search for G, living in France, in Paris. Okay, so we are back. Really often I have this question, is Elasticsearch going to slow down your injection process, actually, in the database? So let's do a simple example. I'm going in the person service layer. Instead of sending the document to MySQL and Elasticsearch, I'm just going to send it to Elasticsearch and see what is happening. Okay. I need to change something because as I'm not sending the document to MySQL anymore, I don't have an ID generated, so I'm going to tell Elasticsearch, I'm not going to provide you an ID, so please auto-generate an ID for me. So this is what Elasticsearch is going to do here. Okay, let's compile that. Okay, and let's again index 1,000 people. Boom. 10,000. Boom. Okay, let's go for 1,000,000 documents. Okay, so using only Elasticsearch is super fast, right? So I guess that Elasticsearch is not going to slow down your injection process when you are dealing with a normal database. Right? Specifically, if you have multiple entities spread multiple tables, right? A complex model. So let's go back here. Let's search. So I can search. You can see the number of documents increasing. I can search within my documents, right? And it's fast. This is the goal of a search engine. It's fast. So I can search in whatever field. Here again, living in France, in Paris, whatever the number of documents I have. Can we do more than that? Actually, I would like to understand how my result set is distributed. And we can do that with what we call aggregation in Elasticsearch. So let's build something like this. In the search method here, I can say I have my query, and I want to add to compute some aggregations. So basically, I'm asking Elasticsearch to break my result set here by country, and I'm saying that I want to compute what is the number of documents broken per country. And I'm going to generate a bucket per address.country.axe-value. It's like doing a group by count order by the top values that you have. So this is what I'm generating here. And I'm building another aggregation, which is a date histogram. On the date of birth field, I want you to compute a bucket for every year, and I want you to compute what is the number of documents that I have for every single bucket. Okay, this is what I'm doing. So let's compile that again, and let's search. So now I can see the distribution of my documents broken by country or by tenure. So if I'm searching for Joe, I can see this distribution of people, right? I have enough time, I think. So maybe you want to filter the result set and navigate through the result. So if you want to click here, I want to filter the result and do what we call faceting navigation. So how can you implement that? I'm going again to type super fast. Yes, yeah. Going to add filters. So coming from the interface, I can have a filter by country or a filter by date. And if I have anything in the filter by country or the filter by date, I'm going to wrap the query that I built before, so either match role or the multi-match query, within a Boolean query. It means that it must match what I have here. And I want to filter the results based on what the user sent. Either filter by country or filter with a range query between two dates. I am computing a decade here, plus 10 years. I think I can do it. So if I'm filtering people living in France and in the 50 called Joe, okay, so now I have the filter and navigation and faceting navigation thing. Okay, can we do more? Yes, in Elasticsearch, you can, instead of computing one simple level of aggregation, you can do aggregations of aggregations of aggregations, so a tree of aggregation. So I'm starting from the same aggregation that we have seen before, computing by country, but then for every single bucket per country, I want to have the distribution of my people living in this country per year. Actually, per almost 10 years here, this is what I'm saying. And for every single bucket of 10 years, I want you to compute the average number of children that you have. Okay? Let's change the interface. This is okay for my HTML skills. Okay. I can add a button. and refresh. Let's have a look at the result. So now I have the distribution of my documents broken per country, then broken per 10 years, and the average number of children that I have here. So I can search for Joe, and now I can understand what is my dataset looking like, actually. Okay, last, not least, remember that I wanted to be able to search for GSmooth. It still does not work. And I need to help Elasticsearch for that. I need to change the search part. And I want to say, okay, you are going to search in the name field and the full text field, but I'm going to allow you what we call a fuzziness factor here. And the factor will be 1, which means 1 edit distance. I can remove a letter, add a new letter, switch from one letter to another. So this is an edit distance of 1. So let's do that. Okay, if I search for GSmooth now, okay, I have my result. Okay. I can do that for the advanced search as well. Here, you can add the fuzziness factor if you wish. It can be auto, depending on the size of the term that you are searching for. But basically, here I'm using one. So if I'm searching for Jean living in France, in Paris, okay, I can get my result. Okay? So once you have indexed everything inside Elasticsearch, you can use Kibana to do other things. So it's here. So I can here just filter my result set within two periods, those two dates. So I have my 1 million documents here. I can see the distribution of my documents. So this is basically the result of a date histogram that you can visualize. But you can build nice dashboards using Kibana. So you can see what is the power of the aggregation that you have. You see here, this is the distribution of my people by geolocation point, date, what have you. And again, if I search for Joe here, born in the, I don't know, can I do that, in the 70s, here, living in whatever country, here, and I want to search for them in this area. Okay, let's select people living here. Okay, so I have basically my result here. Right, so this is a free goodie for you. Well, once you have indexed everything inside Elasticsearch, you just plug Kibana on top of that, and then you start to discover your data. I think I'm done, right? I have no time left. Oh, 2 minutes, normally. So if we look at what we have here, if I can open that. Did you ask for questions? No, you did not, okay. You were too focused on the talk, right? Okay. So I'm done. Thank you.